My name is Paul Cope. I serve as the Assistant District Superintendent for the Christian and Missionary Alliance here in Western Pennsylvania. What does that mean? What do I do? I oversee the 150 churches in Western Pennsylvania, and I work alongside our District Superintendent David Noggle. I give greetings from him to you today as they're in prayer with us for your congregation as you are seeking God for the right pastor and working with your elders here. So I live in the little town of Mars in Butler County, but oftentimes I am here about once a week, and there's a house that the district owns there up by the Punxsutawney Hospital, and I will frequent that place. We stayed there last night, and then we'll head back tomorrow for a district board meeting. Hey, I want to speak about that men's link. I've been privileged to attend numbers of times. This year I'm not able to attend because of my schedule, but it is just a great time. If you guys like to shoot Mark, and I'm not Mark Jordan, you know, but if you like, and you like the contest type stuff, it is so very special. And Ed Jaliff, of course, brings a real powerful message from God's Word. So I want to encourage you to do that. It's a great time, but don't only do it yourself, but invite a neighbor who does not yet know Jesus as Savior, okay? Because it's not just there to entertain, you know, the saints. It's there to see people come to faith in Christ. So please do that, guys. Invite your neighbor, classmate at school, whatever, and just have a really good time, because it is a really a powerfully fun time together. So, you know, I don't know about you, but this past Monday afternoon, I was standing in the parking lot of one of our churches, just kind of talking with a couple of the guys from the church there. And the neighbor guy comes running over, a guy I had never met before, screaming, "Do you want to see the eclipse?" Well, I'd heard about this eclipse for weeks on end, and I was kind of sick and tired of hearing about the eclipse, really. And so I hadn't really given it that much thought that day. I didn't buy special glasses and all that kind of stuff like some people did. I was kind of fed up with the commercialism. Anybody else fed up with the commercialism about the eclipse? Yeah. And all the hype just turned me off. So I wasn't really thinking about the eclipse until this guy that I never met before comes running up to me. "Do you want to see the eclipse?" So he stuck his glasses on me, and I looked. And I was fascinated as I saw the moon come across the horizon, the aurora of the sun. And wow, I was amazed. And then I handed the glasses to somebody else that was with me, and we passed the glasses all around so everybody got a good look. Wow. And, you know, the sun and the moon and the planet Earth, they came in direct alignment. A phenomenal event which hasn't really been seen like this in the United States since before the United States was a country. It was just an amazing event, and I was wowed away. It's really about these celestial bodies lining up together. And I realized it's a God thing. It is a God thing. These planets swinging around in Earth, you know, in their spheres, and they come right lined up together. Well, you're probably saying, where in the world's Cope going with this at this time? Every day, if we can see it, we see phenomenal things when God brings people and situations together to his praise and to the good of you, his people. And for us to recognize this, to give God the praise. As parents and children who had been previously going their own in separate ways, finally line up together. Like a team of horses, you know, to get here from Butler County, I come through Smicksburg. And you see the Amish people with their horses and those big, huge horses lined up together, making an impression on the earth. Or a football team. You know, they got to work together if they're really going to win the game. In the situation here at Punxsutawney Alliance Church, God is preparing you to line up with your new pastor. And so my prayer is that this new pastor, whom you and I don't know, but God already has picked out, as the congregation, as the elders, line up with this new pastor, like the sights of a gun, lining up together to really shoot the mark and to have victory. That's what it's about. Well, let me read a story to you, a true story, where people lined up together, prayed together, worked together, fought together to see a phenomenal victory. It's found in Exodus chapter 17. You're going to want to follow along in your Bible. Exodus chapter 17, verse 8. Exodus chapter 17, verse 8. The Amalekites came and attacked the Israelites at Rephidim. Moses said to Joshua, "Choose some of our men and go out to fight the Amalekites. Tomorrow I will stand on top of the hill with the staff of God in my hands." And by the way, this is the first time that it's called the staff of God. Before this, it was Moses' staff. Somewhere in between, he recognized what all of us have to do, need to do, to recognize all that we have really belongs to God. Even if it's just a walking stick, God gives it to us to use just for this season. And so he had the staff of God in my hands, Moses says. Verse 10, so Joshua fought the Amalekites as Moses had ordered, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went to the top of the hill. As long as Moses held his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. When Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone, put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur held his hands up, one on one side, one on the other, so that his hands remained steady until sunset. So Joshua overcame the Amalekite army with the sword. When the Lord said to Moses, "Write this in a scroll as something to be remembered and make sure that Joshua hears it, because I will completely blot out the name of Amalek from under the heaven." Moses built an altar and called it, "The Lord is my banner." He said, because hands, like a banner waving, because hands were lifted up to the throne of the Lord. The Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation. Do we hear about a nation called the Amalekites today? No, because God wiped them out. And there are reasons why, and we'll go into that as we go on. You see, the Jewish people were on their exodus out of Egypt where they had been slaves for 400 years. And they traveled as a nation, thousands of people, toward the promised land. And remember, they crossed the Red Sea and how the Lord separated the sea and they walked over on dry land. And then when the Egyptian army came by and Moses held out the rod and the sea closed in and the Egyptian army was drowned and killed. And then they come to Rephidim. Now, chapter 17, the first part of the chapter, they had no water. And they started crying out to Moses. And remember how God brought water from the rock. And they had water to drink and to bathe and wash their clothes and go swimming or whatever else they wanted to do in it. But the people in verse 7, I didn't read verse 7, and he called the place Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" Hey, they had seen these miracles. One of the greatest miracles with the parting of the Red Sea. Another miracle where they prayed and water gushed out of the rock. Oh, we haven't seen anything from God. And they tested God and said, "Is the Lord really here or not?" God cannot bless people. He cannot bless a church unless there's faith. And so God had to show them again his presence, his power. And he allowed the Amalekites to come in chapter 17 and verse 8. You know, God allows trials to come to us to build our faith strong. He'll show us the victories, but the greatest victories come through some horrible trials. You've seen that. Sometimes we don't even get it. And the Israelites, they didn't get it. God, you see, wants unity. He wants faith-filled oneness, alignment with his people. And in God's sanctifying grace, he wonderfully brings a spirit of unity, even as the psalm writer says, "How good and how blessed it is when brothers dwell together in unity. For there the Lord commands the blessing, even life everlasting." Well, I want us to show us how that God brought people together in alignment, giving them faith, and what wonderful things God did. 6 steps to build unity at Punxsutawney Alliance Church so that you're united. And I know you've come through a time of great healing for your church. And God blessed wonderfully. And so as God continues his healing work at Punxsutawney Alliance Church, I want us to see those steps. Number 1, unite for the battles of life. We all face battles. God allows them to come to build our faith strong. And so oftentimes Christians fight among themselves instead of fighting the real enemy, the real battles. The Jews were quarreling among themselves, verse 7, when they really should have been fighting the enemies. The Amalekites came and fought with Israel at Rephidim. Now, God had shown how his hand was at work, delivering them from the slavery of sin, leading them across the Red Sea or through the Red Sea. And the Red Sea experience is symbolic to us of our salvation, how that God led us out of slavery to sin to the victory and the freedom in Christ Jesus, how that he forgives our sin and gives us his gift of eternal life. But shortly after a person's saved, you've probably seen it, as they walk down the pathway of godliness, along comes the enemy and the battle. Haven't you seen it? Somebody gets saved, and about a week later, the enemy comes in and attacks them horribly. You can expect it. And you, as a body of believers, need to be there to help to nurture that new Christian. Friends, we are at war today. The enemy is very prevalent. Even as Paul writes in the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, we struggle not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the power of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God. Some of you are facing battles today. Some of you have faced battles this past week. Some of you are in the middle of a battle, even as I'm preaching today, and your mind is distracted, and you're worried or anxious, fearful, maybe angry. Some of the battles are sicknesses, weakness. Some of you struggle with dysfunctions in your home or at your workplace. We in the United States, if you haven't realized it, are facing some horrible strife. The drug situation with opiates is out of control. The situation in Charlottesville, we're just like the Jewish people. We're fighting among ourselves instead of fighting the real battles of life. Some are facing battles with marriages. Some face battles within your own heart, struggles which are so deep, hurts that took place years ago, and you still have never recovered. There's more to the picture of Exodus chapter 17 than we realize. Amalek. What do we know about Amalek? Amalek was the grandson of Esau. Do you remember Esau? Esau's the guy that sold his birthright, his inheritance, for a little bowl of soup. He was more interested in his hunger, physical, than he was in his relationship with God, in his relationship with his family. Amalek is a symbol of the flesh. Did you get the fill in the blank sheets? Anybody, did everybody get one? Okay. Amalek is the symbol of the flesh. It's not on the video, so you can't see it. And there are many Christians who, although they've been set free from the guilt of sin, they're saved. I'm not questioning their salvation. Just like Israel was free from Egypt, but yet they quarreled among themselves. And so there are some Christians, yes, truly born again Christians, who struggle with the temptations of the flesh. There are guys right here in this room who struggle with pornography. and you're tempted to turn on your computer and look at those pictures. And it seems so innocent, but it eats away at the very heart of you. We have Christians who have fleshly attitudes. They're more interested in what they look like to men than they are what they look like before God. Flesh that says, I can do it myself. Or look at me, how hard I work. The flesh that says, I don't feel like getting up today. Or the flesh that says, I'll tell her a thing or two, set her straight. The flesh. And it will cripple us. And it will destroy us from the inside. Friends, don't play games with the flesh. Moses chose to do war with Amalek. And you can do war through the power of the Holy Spirit with the flesh and see the victory. That's what sanctification is about. Taking our stand against the temptations of the flesh in the power of the Holy Spirit. And to do this, Moses chose a friend to come alongside. His name was Joshua. Now the name Joshua, if you translate it from Hebrew, it's a Hebrew word. If you translate it into Greek, the New Testament was written in Greek, the Old Testament in Hebrew. Translated into Greek, it's the name Jesus. Fill in the blanks. And Moses chose Joshua. He chose to be a partner with Joshua. And so, friends, choose your comrades wisely. Verse 9. Moses said to Joshua, choose some of our men and go out to fight with the Amalekites. God didn't expect you to do the work alone. He expects you to partner with other people. That's what church is, when we partner together to serve the Lord. That's what it's about. And he gives other people to help us in our battles. I said yes to God and yes to a woman. Her name is Connie. We celebrated our anniversary this past Wednesday. And although Connie isn't up here, and she would never want to be up here, that's just Connie. She's back there praying. We're partners together. It's fun to work together in the ministry of the Lord. Do you have prayer partners? I love it when Mark announced the prayer meeting. 6 o'clock. Don't get all dressed up, just come and pray. And partner together with other. I know you can pray at home alone, but when you partner together, Jesus said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, I'm in the midst. And notice this verse. Verse 9 says, Moses said to Joshua, choose some of our men. Not all of them. Choose some. Friends, make your choices wisely. Choose your friends wisely. Not everybody who comes along. should be your friend. Choose your partners in ministry wisely. And notice that Moses chose Joshua for an enormous task of leading the Israeli army. This is the first time that we read Joshua's name in the Bible. The best comrade that you can choose is Jesus. If you've never chosen Jesus to be your Savior, if you've never said, "Oh God, I want you to live in me, to forgive my sins, to guide me," there's no better time than right today for you to open your heart and say, "Please, Lord, come in." Have you chosen Jesus to be your Savior? If you have, be sure that He will go with you and He will fight the battles for you. Joshua said it this way, "But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Fathers, have you said that about your family? Have you claimed them for Jesus? The next step, if we're going to see real unity at Punxsutawney Alliance Church, recognize human weaknesses. Moses said, "I'm going to stand up on that hill." And after he stood there a while, with his hands raised up, he got tired, didn't he? Verse 12, the first part of the verse says, Moses' hands got heavy. And while on this earth, we have to deal with human weakness. I like the hymn that says, "I am weak, but thou art strong." When the disciples fell asleep in the Garden of Gethsemane the night before Jesus died on the cross, Jesus lovingly explained, "The spirit is willing, but the flesh is..." Come on, talk to me. You know, I preach in some of the African American churches. We have four of them in the district. And they talk to the preacher. It's lots of fun. It's distracting at times, but it's lots of fun. Yeah. So important to know your weaknesses. Your pastor is not God. He will have weaknesses. And the sooner you find out those weaknesses and how you can couple and support him in those weaknesses will be truly beneficial to you and to him and to the Punxsutawney Alliance Church. So important for you to know your weaknesses. And friends, every strength is a potential weakness. One of my strengths is the gift of showing mercy. People that are struggling to come alongside them and help them out. But that very gift, that very strength can also be a weakness. You see it. Our nation, in trying to show mercy to poor people, they've developed, you know, the welfare system. And although the welfare system in the United States is the best in the world, that can also be a weakness. And so recognizing our weakness and trusting God. Sometimes we don't like to know our weaknesses. We don't like to admit to our weaknesses. Sometimes we don't like other people to know our weaknesses. That's a pride thing. Paul wrote it this way in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. God said to Paul, "My grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made" what? Come on, Christians. Is made perfect in what? In weakness.
So to acknowledge our weakness before God, the Apostle Paul responded to the voice of the Lord and said, "Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am," come on, "strong." Moses' weakness was so obvious. His arms got tired. But Moses' weaknesses gave opportunity for people to come alongside him and support him and help him and shore him up and strengthen him. And so the next step in developing unity at Punxsutawney Alliance Church is support the leadership. Verse 12 says, Aaron was on one side, and this guy, we don't know very much about him, his name was Hur, but he was on the other side holding up hands. What a picture of helping the leadership. Your elders, they need your support right now as never before to uphold them, to encourage them in the work of the Lord. Some might have said, well, let's get a new leader, a stronger man who can hold his arms up. But they would have missed the blessing. Can you imagine Aaron and Hur going back and telling their grandkids, do you know what happened? Moses was praying and he was holding up his hands and he got tired and we held his arms up and God gave the victory. What a blessing. And they would have missed out if they hadn't been there supporting their leadership. As your new pastor comes, supporting him. How can you support him? The symbol of raised hands in a congregation. And I notice not too many people at Punxsutawney Alliance Church raise their hands in the worship. I would hope that would change. Okay, our Pentecostal friends have something here. Because if you read the Bible over and over and over again, raised hands were a symbol of two things. The first is prayer. The New Testament, 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 8, I desire then that in every place the men should pray, lifting holy hands. That's what the Bible says. Are you doing it? It's a symbol of prayer to God. And it's a symbol of praise to the Lord. Which, prayer and praise, they go, you can't have one without the other, you know? Psalm number 63. So I will bless you as long as I live. In your name, I will lift up my hands. Helping your leader with these two vital activities, prayer and praise, are vitally important. In a time when I faced horrible strife in my ministry and my church was going through terrible firestorms, and some of you know little bits about it, my elders lifted up my hands. They supported me in prayer. And I was consciously aware that they were right there beside me in prayer before God and in praise. Back when I went to junior high school, we had the first time in my life that I had a school that would provide cafeteria food service. And one of the women that worked in the cafeteria, I didn't know this for 50 years later. Her name was Margaret Greger. She's now home in glory. But when she'd see me walking through the cafeteria line, she would pray for me. Just as simple as that. Bless this little kid, as ornery as he is. You too can join in prayer and praise. I have people who pray for me every day. Some of you know Janet Jones, pastor's wife. Janet prays for me every day. She lives in Dubois. And if you'd ask her, she'd pray for you too. I need that. Not only was her and Aaron involved in holding up Moses' arms, but remember there was a fourth person in this alignment, Joshua. He was down in the valley. He was fighting the battles. They were praying for him. They were praying for the army guys. And so too, there's a whole army of men down in the valley fighting the battle. Let's thank God. Let's praise God. Let's pray as never before in the history of Punxsutawney Alliance Church and see God pour out the blessing. A fifth step, and vitally important to see, if you're going to have unity in the church, rest in the Lord. Verse 12, in the middle of the verse, they took a stone, sat it there, rolled it up there, and said, now, Moses, you sit on the stone. They saw the importance of rest. The book of Hebrews says there remains a rest for the people of God. The Sabbath is God's gift to us. Enjoy it. Don't waste it by working it away. By resting on the Sabbath, you're saying, I'm trusting God to do more than I could ever do myself. And God wants you to rest, not only physically, but spiritually. To make time to rest, to give our needs to the Lord and trust Him to answer prayer, to rest in the Lord. And that's hard for me to do. My pride wants to do it myself. I'll never forget, first district conference I ever attended, Reverend George Jones, during the communion service, saying, Jesus, I am resting in the joy of what thou art. Some of you know that song. It's old. Remember Mary and Martha. Which one did Jesus commend? The one that was busy working, or the one that sat at Jesus' feet to rest? And there's a time to work, but there's a time to rest. And so may we learn what it is to rest, to really rest in the Lord. And number six, if we're going to really see unity and blessing at Punxsutawney Alliance Church, give God the praise. Moses built an altar on that hill. And he named the altar Jehovah Nissi, which means the Lord is my banner. And he said, because hands were lifted up to the throne of the Lord. The Hebrew word, your NIV translates it against, but the Hebrew word means toward the Lord. And so we may we raise our banner to the Lord. A banner is a flag. And I see flags all over this place. It's flag waving time. We all need flag waving times. Times when we can celebrate. And Sunday is a day of celebration as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. That's why we do it the first Sunday, first day of the week. I'm asking that we lift our hands in praise to God, in worship to Him, as we unite in praise to God. Friends, the effectiveness of the eclipse is because these celestial bodies lined up perfectly in order. God wants to give us the victory, but this can only happen if the people at Punxsutawney Alliance Church are lined up together. Your new pastor, your leaders, your elders at Punxsutawney Alliance Church, the congregation at Punxsutawney Alliance Church, the community around Punxsutawney Alliance Church. It's time to line up for what God wants to do at this church. I rarely ever give an invitation for people to join the membership of the church. But I believe that there are some here that need to take your stand and say, yes, I've attended for a long time, but I need to be a member of Punxsutawney Alliance Church. Are you ready to make that commitment? There's some here who have never lined up with Jesus and said, Lord, I need you to be my Savior, to come into my life and forgive my sins today. You can do that. And we can work together in the great work of the Lord. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the privilege of prayer, the privilege to come before your throne and lift our hands before you in praise to you, O God, to give testimony of faith in the Lord Jesus, to love you. And so bind this church together in unity, in love for one another, that the name of Jesus our Savior would be glorified, praised in every way. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.